Today, I want to talk about fine-tuning the interior shape based on the notes that you need to play. This is a continuation of the previous video, which talked about the basic EU or umlaut shape and the need for it to be constantly adjusted based on registration and even particular notes that you want to play. I should say at this point that it's important to understand that there are different approaches to this fine-tuning aspect. There are players who will adjust the position of the mouthpiece in the embouchure slightly, either by looking up or down or moving things around. The school that I come from Mr. Marcellus, was of a very strong opinion that the jaws, lips, and position of the instrument do not change when playing and changing registers, that it should remain virtually the same for every note on the instrument. And I think that this, when it works well, is ideal because you don't have to worry about physically moving exterior parts and taking risks in that regard, particularly when you're trying to do wide slurs or tongue widely divergent notes in different registers right away. You don't have to move that. It should be said, however, that some of the players who utilize this moving around technique are some of the finest players in the world. So you have that on the other side. So just to demonstrate a little bit that this is totally possible to do. For the most extreme of the high notes, it may be necessary at times just to do a little bit, just to especially if the reed isn't quite where you want it to be. But basically, that is without moving anything on the exterior. So, how are we going to find the ideal location to get the registration that we need at the exact moment that we need it and then memorize it physically? This exercise and series of exercises is not based directly on my studies with Mr. Marcellus. We never talked about this so much, but it's pieced together from conversations with many people over the years and my own experimentation. I break it down into two areas. One is the poise of the middle of the tongue going toward the reed to make sure that you've got enough wind speed to maintain the registration. This I experiment with by taking the high C, the thumb C, releasing the register key and going down chromatically and trying to make sure that the registration of the upper register is maintained and try to get as low as it's possible to get without doing that. It sounds rather ugly, but you'll find that if you can get to the lowest B without dropping the register, that you're really getting a good efficient use of the air. Etc. So I had to tap the register key on the way back up, but I made it down in reasonable shape. What I feel in that exercise as I get lower is that make sure that middle of the tongue and the front of the tongue are right close to the reed and really keeping that EU shape. Maybe I can actually stop in the middle and pronounce whatever it is that I'm doing. That's it. I thought I'd stop right about there because E seems to be the point where a lot of students simply cannot maintain. So you really have to have that particular shape. Now, that's just a basic setup exercise. Now let's look at some of the notes that cause problems in the registrational process, particularly for articulation. And this is the middle and upper clarion and the third register. If we analyze what's going on there, most of the notes from your low A up until certainly D, there are three notes that come with each of those fingerings that we use regularly. For instance, with A, we have A, we have E, and we have C sharp. So if we're determined that the embouchure and the angle of the clarinet and all that is going to be the same for all those, we're not going to do all of that, then how are we going to make sure that the E is nice and centered and not scoopy, that we don't have that, and that the C sharp doesn't have the famous seems like the reed has dried out, but we're trying to avoid scoops and grunts. In other words, to have the start of the note really clean, like it should be. So it seems the best way to do this is to try to play those notes with only one fingering, the low A fingering, not adding the register key, not lifting the first fingering, and see if we can start them cleanly simply by changing the air column. Again, the tone color will not be pleasant, and occasionally you'll get some grunts and chips. But if you can really start to center those notes, and A is probably a harder one, so I will start on C, which is a little bit easier to do. There you have it. So if you use those same positions that are necessary to do that, you should be able to achieve a nice clean attack on all of those. This is assuming that your articulation is in good shape and is being properly maintained and executed. But that's a whole nother series of videos, and we'll see if I ever get around to making those. Now, as long as you're going to do this exercise, or any exercise, my feeling is you should always try to find a way to improve your sense of rhythm and your musicianship at the same time. So let's add the metronome to this little exercise, and not just use it in a normal way, but use it in a creative way by doing it with the offbeats, forcing you to really subdivide the beat. This is a nice slow tempo. And so I will try to run through this series and see if I can get every single note to speak. It's not so easy, even though I've been doing this for a while, and see what happens. Something very important that occurs to me. Do not bite the reed. Do not change the pressure of the jaw against the reed as you go higher. That actually is defeating the purpose of this exercise. And while it may help you to squeeze out some of those notes, it will ultimately not help you achieve them with a good sound and good intonation later. If you and I are subscribing to the same embouchure concept, we will be playing with the jaws quite open all the time, and creating the resistance, not through closing the reed with our jaw, but through this interior shape of the embouchure. Now, all of those things, if you can master all of those, will allow you to get to the next level of playing the clarinet, which would be when you can do this exercise and never think about the position of the tongue, which is not what I was doing when I was playing that exercise. I was noticing the position of the tongue, but I was not thinking about where the tongue should go. What I was thinking about was playing A, E, C sharp, E, A. I was just playing those notes and thinking them, and that caused the note to change. And the tongue went where it was supposed to go. Ultimately, that's the level where you need to be, is that the control system is the musical need, and the physical part does what it's supposed to do. Therefore, when I need to get an E, I go to right to the position. I don't have to think about where does my tongue go to play E. If occasionally I'm practicing a piece of music and I consistently chip a note or hit a subtone, then I will work on it that way. Let me talk about one special note, which is the 1 and 1 B flat, which is a rare species with some clarinet players. And in fact, when I was young, I didn't use it much myself. Although my teacher, Mr. Marcellus, was a huge fan of this fingering. And if you listen very carefully to his many, many recordings, you will hear him reach for this 1 and 1 B flat, even in times where it's not technically that convenient, because he loved the way it sounded so much. And I have grown to embrace it as well, particularly in the arpeggios of certain keys. But it has a very particular kind of feel and resistance to it, this note, that makes it very useful in some interesting situations, which my teacher pointed out to me, one of which has to do with the D that's just above it. If you need to make a soft attack on it or slur gently to it, Mr. Marcellus would said, don't worry about that. Think of it as a 1 and 1 B flat, and that D will come right out. And it's actually a very useful little trick. So that's your bonus for today.